What's going on, everyone? My name is Parag Jethani. I'm an MD/MBA student here at Yale University, and I'm actually starting residency 2022. I actually applied for residency right now, and that's actually what exposed me to this whole topic of understanding residencies, understanding the average step one score, number of publications, service experiences, all those things. So this entire video series is intended to educate you on that, and today we're going to be talking specifically about general surgery. So if you look at general surgery, this is a big specialty, and obviously I've done several videos in the past. My personal specialty is going to be internal medicine, so I have an internal medicine video. There's also a family medicine video, and I'm creating a playlist of just specific specialty focused videos. The source of each of these videos is from the Report on Residence, which is a AAMC report that is published. So all of the stuff I'm telling you is technically objective data based on the class of interns that started in 2021. And so hopefully all of this makes sense. And as always, if you want to follow along on any social media, that's usually where I am. So now let's actually just talk a bit about what exactly general surgery is, because it's very ambiguous at times. And I personally didn't know much about general surgery when I started medical school. General surgery is a surgical subspecialty or surgical specialty that focuses on abdominal contents, usually like liver, spleen, esophagus, stomach, small intestine, large intestine. So if you think about a general surgeon, they're usually going to be operating on the abdomen area. Within general surgery, you can also have fellowships, and fellowships are essentially ways for you to become more specialized as a surgeon. Subspecialty and fellowship training usually is after general surgery training and can include things such as minimally invasive surgery, surgical oncology, transplant surgery, hepatobiliary surgery, endocrine surgery. Much like in my specialty of internal medicine, where you can subspecialize and become a cardiologist, general surgery is kind of the internal medicine equivalent of surgery, where you can then subspecialize in specific facets if you are interested in that, such as minimally invasive surgery. So with all that being said, let's now jump into the statistics. In each of these videos, I like to start with a general demographic overview, which is also provided in the AAMC report. And so you'll see that this whole thing shows you the general surgery and the total number of active residents. Notice that in this case, we're not only talking about the first year class, we're talking about the number of active surgical residents throughout all of residency programs within the United States. And you can see that there's 9,625. And within those 9,625, you have three categories, which are IMGs, MDs, and DOs. PowerPoint consistently autocorrects the DOs. You have 15% IMGs, 73% MDs, and 12% DOs. And then within each of them, you can see that I have broken them down by the percent of males and females. So you can see that 10% of general surgery residents across the United States of the 9,625 are male IMGs. 38.4 are male MDs. 34.7 are female MDs. And actually, this was really impressive to me, the fact that male and female MDs are about equivalent as our male and female DOs, just because I was under the impression that surgical specialties were a little bit more male-dominated, but it's good to know it's rectifying, and we are seeing the increase in females. You can now also see I'm comparing general surgery to my specialty of internal medicine here, and I only do this one, to show you the different types of breakdowns in terms of, you know, training and demographics, but two, to also show you the wide variety that you have of individual slots, right? So internal medicine, for example, there's 28,000 internal medicine residents, whereas there's 9,625 surgical residents. Also notice that general surgery is usually a much longer residency. And so if it's a five-year residency, this 9,625 is divided by five subclasses. 5 to 7 years because of training, so it's 5 to 7 subclasses, whereas internal medicine is usually three years of training, and so this 28,000 is broken down into three subclasses. The other thing I want to point out is that in both cases, you have more males than females, but the other thing that is also important to note is that there is a much larger MD population in general surgery than is in internal medicine. Notice that internal medicine, you almost have a complete equal breakdown between IMGs and MDs, whereas IMGs make up a much smaller proportion of general surgery residents percent-wise. Now, let's get into the heart of everything, which is the Step 1 and Step 2 CK scores. As you know, Step 1 is going pass-fail soon, and I've made a video on that, but for the sake of the data in this case, Step 1 was out of 300, with 250 being a very competitive score, and similarly, Step 2 was also the same way. The way you can interpret this graph is that this data is actually for 1,337 first-year residents in general surgery. So notice that overall, the total number of general surgery residents is 9,625, but this is only for the first incoming intern class of general surgery residents. And because this is for residents who are starting and not just residents who are applying into general surgery, these numbers are obviously going to be higher because these are residents that actually matched and started. So with all that being said, let's now understand this. So what does this 111 mean, for example? Well, this 111 means that of the 1,300 applicants who were accepted into the first year general surgery intern class, 111 had step one scores of 230 to 239 and step two scores of 250 to 259, right? Similarly, if you look here, one general surgery incoming resident in the first year class 2021 had a step one score of 210 to 219 and a step two score above 259. On the other hand, 60 had step two scores above 259 and step one scores above 259. And then if you wanted to look specifically at step one and step two, that's where you would look at rows and columns. So if you look here, 30% of general surgery residents in the first year class had a step two CK score of above 250. And if you then look here, you have 17% who had a score above 259. Similarly here, 5.9% had a step one score above 259 and 13.8% had a step one score from 250 to 259. So that's how you understand that data. Now, if you want to break this down a little bit further in terms of percentiles, percentiles actually tell you how much better you are than X percent of the population. So for example, the 75th percentile means that this score is better than 75% of the incoming first year class. So notice that, as I said, there's about 1,300 first year general surgery residents who started in 2021. Of that, the 75th percentile score was 246. So if you scored above a 246 on step one, you are better than 75% of the people who are starting general surgery residency. Similarly, the average score, which means you take all the step one scores and divide it by the total number of scores, was 235, and the average step two score was 247. Similarly, the complex scores are included here as well. Notice that the number of individuals who took the complex exams was much smaller than step one, and primarily this is a reflection of the fact that there aren't as many DOs as MDs, and therefore the DO proportions is going to be a bit smaller. And now, just wanted to obviously compare this to my specialty, which is internal medicine. And I do this not because I want to make, you know, rifts between specialties, but just to show you the wide variation across specialties and to show you that regardless of your score, there are going to be people who make it into each of these specialties, despite what you may think is a bad score. And even with really good scores, you may not always get it. So actually notice that the 90th percentile scores are actually very similar in both cases, right? For general surgery, it's 256, 264, 254, 262. Similarly, the 90th percentile score for the DOs seems to be much higher than the 90th percentile scores for the DOs in internal medicine. The other thing to remember is obviously internal medicine has many more incoming first-year individuals purely because of the fact that internal medicine had more slots across the country, whereas general surgery has fewer, usually an indication of just the prevalence of doctors who are needed. Now, last but not least, let's end with the number of research experiences, number of publications, volunteer and work experiences. So on average, a general surgery resident who started in 2021 had around 3.5 research experiences, 7 abstracts, presentations, and publications, 4 work experiences, and 8 volunteer experiences. And now you can look at percentiles, obviously, to show you where they stood across different things. So the 90th percentile obviously had 15 abstracts, presentations, and publications, 7 work experiences, 13 volunteer experiences. But all of this to say, clearly there's a wide variety of things. This just kind of shows you the general barometer of what it takes to become a general surgery resident. Exceptional field. You can see here, I loved my surgery rotation. I don't think I could ever be a good surgeon, but I did enjoy being in the OR. And so with all of this, I hope you all enjoyed this video. If you did, drop a like, comment, share, subscribe, and I'll see you all in the next one. Thank you so much for watching. Peace.